Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blood and Steam by Jamie Sedgwick. Narrated by Shiromi Arserio. Blood and Steam, Part 1. Prologue. I never knew my mother. I was little more than a babe when she headed out into that vast frozen wilderness known as the Wastelands in her old spring-powered plane, searching for the fabled lost city in the ice. According to legends, the city is a strange, mystical place, filled with wild magic and incredible advanced technology. My mother believed she might find something there to help us, some superior weapon or science that might give us an edge in the war against the Vangars. She never returned. My mother left me in the care of an old eccentric inventor who raised me as his own. I loved him like a father. I called him Tinker, but I never knew his real name until after he died. I was born on the side of a mountain in the spring. It was the year the Vangars invaded, the year they killed our king, decimated our cities, and forced our people into slavery. The banks of the Stillwater River were swollen with the runoff from the melting snow in the Black Rock Mountains. Stories say the river ran red that year, that it overflowed its banks and flooded the plains, and all of the land from Honora south to the Badlands became like a river of blood. Before she left, my mother named me River. It was no mistake she chose that name in that year. I've done my best to live up to it ever since. Chapter 1. I emerged from the alley like a wraith, wings of smoke and shadow curling up behind me, the filtered moonlight splashing like blood against the rusted and decaying buildings that surrounded me. Down the hill and to the west, I could see the flickering lights of Dockside's shanties in the fog, and I heard the distant rumble of a steam locomotive rattling along the tracks towards Avonston with a load of freshly hewn timber and raw black rock steel. I watched its dark shadow pass through the southern end of the city, moving deeper into Dockside. The train's whistle sliced through the night, echoing back and forth through the maze of darkened streets. Somewhere in the distance, a child began to cry. A chill ran up and down my spine as I saw the red crescent moon peeking through the layer of smoke that blanketed the city, and the words of Tinker's eerie warning echoed through the back of my mind. I shuddered, remembering the wild look in his eyes. "Don't go out tonight, River. It's a blood moon. Dark forces are working against us." It was terrifying and tragic all at once. Seeing one of the greatest minds of our time given over to dementia and superstition like a common peasant. I had been watching Tinker's mental health decline for several years. I could tell that the end wasn't far. His health had been failing ever since the Vangars took him captive before I was born. All these years later, he still wouldn't talk about what they had done to him. In the last few months, Tinker had begun to lose his grip on reality. He saw things, ghosts and monsters, demons from his past. His occasional moments of lucidity were stretching further and further apart, and it was all I could do sometimes just to keep him sedate. I had soothed him with calm words and a warm cup of tea before leaving our Dockside shanty that night. The tea laced with a pinch of powdered duskwood, a mild sedative that would help him sleep through the night. I hated doing that to him, hated drugging the man who had raised me as his own child. I felt I owed him more than that, and yet I had nothing more to offer. What I did, distasteful as it had been, was for his own protection. I knew what the Vangars would do to Tinker if he wandered out into the city during one of his fits. Even if they didn't recognize him, which they probably wouldn't, a crazy old man like Tinker would have been like a plaything to them. They would have toyed with him like cats torturing a field mouse, bringing death in the slowest and most painful ways that their twisted minds could conceive. No. It was better just to let the old man fade away. As long as I could keep him comfortable and well-fed, Tinker would be all right. Heartbreaking as it was, I could give Tinker nothing else. He had peace and comfort, and that was more than most. I drew my attention back to the street, and my fingers twitched nervously for the familiar grip of my revolver, though I knew it was still resting on the bookshelf by the stairs at home. I'd had a feeling in my gut all day, and not just because of Tinker's superstitious rantings. Something just seemed wrong. I should have taken a weapon with me, but I didn't dare break the law by arming myself in public, even late at night and under the cover of darkness. There were too many suspicious eyes on the streets. Too many turncoats ready to sell out to the Vangars for a better job or a few extra coins. The people of Astatia were weak, dependent on their overlords. They had lost their honor, had their senses numbed by fear and starvation, their pride destroyed by decades of slavery. Most of us had nothing left to live for except the instinct for survival itself. Few still had the courage to fight. Those of us who did knew that nothing would come of it but our own inevitable deaths. If nothing else, we had the desire to spill the Vangar's blood. For some, that was enough to keep us going. I hurried into an adjacent alley, my heart pounding as I exposed myself to the weak light of the gas lamps. The sense of impending doom intensified. The blood moon, I thought, gazing up into the thick, black, polluted sky. It's just superstition, that's all. If only it was so easy to believe. A gust of ocean breeze swirled up the smoke and fog, and for a moment, I almost thought I could see the stars. Then the clouds and vapor closed back in, smothering the life out of the sky. I relaxed as the shadows enveloped me. The dark streets of Avonston were my environment, my home. The place had molded me. It was where I had learned to fight, to survive, and to kill. That last one was the most important of all. To survive in the streets of Avonston, one must always be prepared to kill. I slipped down the alley and cautiously made my way to the back door of a dilapidated old engine factory. Like most of the city, the tin-sided building was in a bad state of disrepair. Most of the windows had long since broken out, and the siding was peeling away from the underlying structure in numerous places. It was the type of place that even the Vangars tried to avoid after dark. And that was what made it a perfect place for the sleepwalkers to meet. The hinges creaked noisily as I pulled the door open. I yanked on it and stepped inside, blinking at the darkness. "It's me," I said in a whisper. I heard a shuffling noise and someone pulled the cover away from a lantern. The dim light barely illuminated the faces that peered at me from the darkness. "Are you alone?" Kale said. I nodded, stepping closer. Kale and the others had gathered around a table covered in a pile of gears and machinery parts. The skeletal frames of engine hoists and factory equipments rose up from the shadows behind them like obelisks. I glanced at their faces as I stepped up to the table, taking a mental roll call. All of the regular sleepwalkers were there. Sleepwalkers was what we called our little group of rebels, because we only dared meet late at night under the cover of darkness. It gave us a way to refer to the group in code, so that if the Vangars or other outsiders overheard us talking, they wouldn't know what we meant. We were the only resistance, a small handful of revolutionaries, plotting and scheming against our overlords in the hope that someday we would throw off the yoke of oppression and drive the Vangars back to their homeland, across the frigid sea. Hatch and Shell Woodcarver were there, as always. They were the oldest of the group. The couple had been married longer than most of us had been alive. In fact, they'd raised a child who would have been old enough to be my father, if he hadn't been killed when the Vangars invaded. Hatch was a wily old sailor with a scar on his cheek and a twinkle that came to his eyes every time he talked about killing Vangars. Shell was his perfect match, an age-wizened woman with long, wavy gray hair who knew how to take care of herself. The others, Breck the butcher with broad shoulders and a missing left arm, cut off at the elbow by Vangars in his youth. Tasha the tailor, from the upper crust Hillcrest district, whose entire family had been slaughtered by the Vangars. She had since married and had three children, but still met with us in secret once a week to keep her dream of vengeance alive. There were a few others, but not many, less than a dozen. Our number had been three times that once. Some of us had been killed over the years. Others had simply given up hope. The sleepwalkers were dwindling fast. "Tinker couldn't come tonight," Hatch said. "No, he hasn't been feeling well." "Tell him we miss him," Shell said, "and we hope he gets better soon." I nodded quietly. I didn't have the heart to tell them Tinker wasn't going to get better. "Did you miss me, gorgeous?" Kale said, brushing up against me. He gave me a mischievous smile and I pushed him away. "Stop it. You know you're like a brother to me." "Like a big, muscular, sexy brother that all your friends are in love with?" he said. Laughter broke out around us. "No, more like a very special brother who needs a cork on his fork so he won't put his own eyes out." The others hooted at that one and Kale turned slightly red. I was impressed with myself. Being the ruffian he was, Kale wasn't quick to blush. He had a way with the ladies. He always had ever since he hit puberty at the ripe old age of 11. I couldn't help but think that his only interest in me was due to the fact that I always rebuffed his advances. Or perhaps he just did it to get a reaction out of me. Kale was like that. He had a bit of a mean streak. Like many of us, Kale had his scars to bear. His entire family had been slain during the Vangar invasion, except for his father, who died after a year of hard labor in the Vangar slave mines. Kale had a bright red scar on the side of his face, the size of a man's hand. From a distance, it almost looked like he had been slapped, but up close, it was obvious that he had been badly burned. That happened when a Vangar warrior threw a spear at him but missed and instead impaled the boiler on the back of the steam wagon next to him. Kale bore the scar proudly now, claiming it as proof that the Vangars couldn't kill him. "Every scar makes me stronger," he told me once. "One day I'll be nothing but scars, and then you'll know all the Vangars are dead." Of course, that was but one of many boasts, and I took everything Kale said with a grain of salt. "We've got some good stuff this time," Hatch said, gesturing at the table. I glanced over the pile of parts. "Well, what do you think?" Kale urged. "Can you use this stuff?" I shuffled through the mess, looking for anything useful. "Gears, springs, a few bits of Blackrock steel," I murmured. "No welded pipe?" "Not this time," Kale said. "The Vangars got there too fast." I arched an eyebrow, wondering just what Kale had done to get those materials. I decided it was better if I didn't know. "I can't make weapons without good steel pipe," I said. "Guns need a barrel." One of the gifts I inherited from my mother is the ability to build things. Or perhaps I just picked it up from Tinker. There's no magic to it, I just have a knack at putting the pieces together. I'm something of a mechanic, but my abilities are nowhere near Tinker's nor my mother's, who could reach into a machine and feel the parts with her mind. "Maybe not a gun then," Kale said hopefully. Can't you come up with something else? I glanced at him, and then at the rest of them. If grey hair and wrinkled skin could have made an army, would have been in great shape. Kale and I were the only sleepwalkers left under the age of 30. I'm not an engineer, I sighed. I can fix things or build weapons if I have the right parts, but what can I do with a pile of gears and springs? Maybe Tinker could look at it, see what he thinks. I glanced around the room and saw the disappointed looks on their faces. So much of their hope depended on Tinker. If they knew how bad he was, they might give up altogether. I sighed. I suppose I could show him, if he's up to it, I said. Put this stuff in a bag and I'll take it with me. Excellent, Kale said. I know he'll figure something out. I smiled weakly, already working on the problem in the back of my mind. I knew it would fall to me because Tinker simply didn't have the capacity to build things anymore. It had been 2 years since he'd been in the workshop below our home. That was when he'd finished his last big project, a machine we both referred to as the Bone Shaker. I wasn't sure if he even remembered about it anymore. The others began moving away from the table, talking in low voices as they scattered around the factory. Our meeting was over. In a few minutes, they would all begin quietly making their way back home. I looked at Kale and then back at the pile of materials, wondering what I would possibly make from it all. It was up to me to make something useful out of that pile of junk, and I didn't have the slightest idea where to start. I had almost nothing to work with. A feeling of hopelessness washed over me as I realized how pathetic we were. A handful of revolutionaries with no weapons and no army. Kale and I were the only real fighters in the group. As much as we liked to celebrate our minor victories, I knew we couldn't ever accomplish anything meaningful. Not like this. Not hiding out in abandoned factories trying to plan an insurgency with a pile of rusty nuts and bolts. The best we could ever hope to accomplish was to kill a Vangar now and then, or help a few slaves escape from the mines. That wasn't enough. Our resistance was dying. I know what you're thinking, Kale said, stepping closer. I arched an eyebrow. Is that so? Yes, I can see it on your face. You should remember that any one of them would die for our cause. They probably will eventually, I muttered, if old age doesn't get them first. Kale laughed. He started to say something, but at that moment a massive explosion went off near the front end of the building. I saw a flash of light and heard the sound of tearing metal. A cloud of dust and smoke poured into the factory, filling the front of the building. Screams filled my ears. Someone shouted, "Sentinel!" I exchanged a glance with Kale. We had crossed paths with sentinels before. If this truly was a sentinel, we were in a lot of trouble. Sentinels are Vangars, but they aren't entirely human. Soon after invading our country, the Vangars learned that half-breeds like my mother possess certain gifts. They have the ability to work magic on both machines and living people. The Vangars use this to their advantage, forcing magic users to create strange abominations of man and machine. They experimented first on victims of the war, creating new arms and legs for them, giving fallen soldiers the ability to continue living and working. These artificial limbs were powered by springs at first, but they quickly evolved. It wasn't long before the Vangars were looking for ways to improve their subjects. With springs and steam power, they created powerful robotic arms and legs, and integrated weapons into the soldiers' bodies. These experiments went on for years until the Vangars finally created the ultimate warrior. They called it the Sentinel. Sentinels stand 9 feet tall and have the strength of 20 men. Their armor and helmets protect them from conventional weapons, making them nearly indestructible. The sentinels remain slightly human, but not enough to have any empathy or conscience. If they ever had any, that is. They are Vangars, after all. Sentinels are the perfect killing machines. They have very few weaknesses, and even those are deceptive. For instance, the grated metal visor at the front of their helmets appears to be an opening, but the plate is made of specially treated black rock steel. It's nearly impossible to damage even with a firearm. Most of their armor is similar, and it covers their entire bodies. Against warriors like this, we were helpless. Instantly, we were moving. Kale disappeared into the shadows off to my right, and I raced back to the metal stairway at the center of the building. I leapt over the banister and flew up the stairs. I landed on the catwalk above and paused, scanning the front of the building for a clearer view. At first, I could only see smoke. Then a massive section of the wall gave way with a shrieking sound, and the old lumber collapsed inward, crashing across the floor. The smoke drifted out through the opening, and a sentinel stepped through, his massive steel boots thudding against the floor as he moved. I heard the unmistakable whirring sound of the gears and springs that powered his suit. My gaze went to the scattergun he wore in a long holster at his side, and then to the massive sword strapped to his back. I sized him up, calculating my chances of winning a battle with this creature. I scanned the area for a weapon, wondering what damage I might do with a length of pipe or a scrap of board. Not much, I thought cynically. As the smoke cleared, the sentinel crossed the front of the factory, and I saw another dark form appear in the opening behind him. My heart fell as a second sentinel appeared, and then a third. Three sentinels. We were doomed. In unison, they raised their scatterguns and began firing indiscriminately into the building. A chorus of screams went up in the smoky darkness below me. I heard the sounds of the other sleepwalkers scattering throughout the factory, running for their lives. I broke into a run, flying down the catwalk towards the front of the building. I didn't have a plan at that point. I only knew that I had to distract the sentinels before they killed everyone. I reached the end of the catwalk, and without slowing down, I leapt onto the guardrail and plunged forward, hurling myself over the edge. The sentinels had spread out at the front of the building. I landed directly behind them, touching down as gracefully as a panther. I rose to my feet, glancing at the backs of their suits, wondering at the technological genius that made all those gears and springs work together, meshing flesh and bone. I'm good with machines, but not that good. The half-breed engineers who created the Sentinels were pure genius. Mad genius. I heard the faint clicking and whirring of the machinery under their armor, and noted the steady rattle of the steam condenser and boiler that drove it all. The boiler housings on the back of their suits looked like rectangular boxes made of copper-plated steel. Being an obvious vulnerability, the Vangars had gone to great lengths to protect their power source. I doubted even a high-powered rifle could puncture that boiler. One of the sentinels noticed me. He turned, swinging his scattergun in my direction. I latched onto his arm and heaved myself upward. I moved gracefully, without hesitation. Before he even realized what I was doing, I climbed his suit just like a tree. I stood over the Vangar's helmet, straddling it with one foot on each shoulder. He waved his gun in the air, trying to knock me off, but I easily dodged out of reach.
Miva!
He called out to his companions. Help! At the sound of his voice, the others ceased their firing and turned to see what was the matter. They raised their scatterguns to shoot me, but the sentinel cried out,
Naya! Naya!
If they shot at me, they'd probably kill him too. His armor could protect the Vangar from a weapon like that, but the steel mesh on his helmet was an obvious weakness when it came to scatterguns. He didn't want to risk it. I smiled grimly. I noticed a latch on the side of his helmet, and on a hunch, I pulled the linchpin. I bent my knees and yanked back as hard as I could, thinking that I might have found a way to remove the helmet. It moved slightly, but it was fighting me. I'd missed another latch somewhere. I stood up and kicked it. Instead of pulling free, the helmet twisted sideways, binding against the rest of the suit, leaving the Vangar inside half-blinded. He dropped his scattergun and reached up to straighten the helmet, but his large clumsy hands broke a piece of copper tubing in the process. Hot oil spurted out of the tube, splattering painfully across my arm. I sprang backwards, deftly landing on the ground behind him. As my feet touched down, I heard the warrior inside the suit screaming. The hot oil was working its way through the cracks, burning his skin. I glanced down at my arm and saw a dozen small blisters beginning to form. I almost felt sorry for the Vangar. Almost. The other sentinels had their scatterguns trained on me, but they didn't dare shoot for fear of injuring their companion. Instead, they lowered their weapons and rushed me. I took a cautious step back, making some quick mental calculations, and then dashed for the hole in the wall. I leapt through the opening as the heavy ka-thud of a scattergun went off behind me. I dove for the ground, hoping the stonework foundation might offer some protection. Projectiles riddled the wall above me, tearing holes through the tin siding and hammering into the brick building across the street. The pellets whistled as they ricocheted off the brick wall, sending puffs of dust up in the air. The first shot was high. Luckily, I had gone low. I rolled aside as I landed and came to my feet at the corner of the building. Another shot went off, closer this time but still wildly inaccurate. I cursed myself once again for not bringing a weapon. I should have known better. Standing at the corner of the building, I took a step back, positioning myself at an angle to the adjacent building across the alleyway. With a burst of speed, I ran straight at it. I had learned the trick from a Talmar thief when I was a child. He was the only full-blood Talmar I'd ever met, and he made his living picking the pockets of Vangars and other corrupt businessmen of Avanston. Unbeknownst to Tinker, I had followed the Talmar around for a while, learning his trade. I helped him occasionally, and for this, he gave me trinkets and coins that I used to buy food. More importantly, he taught me certain skills that came in handy later in my life, especially at moments like this. When I reached the corner of the adjacent building, I leapt up, climbing the wall several steps, and then pushed away, twisting as I flew over the narrow alley. As I hit the outside corner of the factory, I curled my legs up like springs. The tin siding rattled noisily as I rebounded, pushing back toward the first building. Just like that, in two jumps, I was within reach of the roof. Or so I thought. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw something dark and massive hurtling towards me. I twisted awkwardly in midair, trying to avoid the object. As I turned, a massive axe whooshed by my head, missing me by an inch. I contorted my body, struggling to regain my balance, straining to reach the roof of the building. As I reached the arc of my flight, I barely caught the ledge with my fingertips. I instantly knew it wasn't enough of a handhold to support my weight. Using my momentum, I swung myself forward, gliding along the side of the building, trying to bring my feet up to the level of the roof. I swung my legs up over my head, curving my knees back towards the ledge. I vaulted upside down and gently came to rest, hanging by my knees with my back against the wall. My hair dangled down beneath me, my arms at my side, fingers searching desperately for a handhold. The hard cobblestone street stretched out below, taunting me. I took a deep breath, analyzing my precarious situation. I'd spent my momentum. There was nowhere else to go. I bent my torso, trying to reach up to the ledge of the roof. My foothold immediately started to give. I felt myself sliding away from the ledge and I quickly straightened out, pressing my back up to the wall. I turned my head to stare awkwardly at the sentinels as they stepped around the corner. They raised their weapons, training their sights on me. I closed my eyes, measuring, calculating. I couldn't drop, not that far and not at that angle. I'd never make it to my feet. I'd break my neck in the fall, and that was if I was lucky. If I wasn't, I'd survive long enough for the sentinels to make me wish I had broken my neck. I heard deep, taunting laughter from below, and the unmistakable click of a scattergun round being loaded into the chamber. Chapter 2. I was as good as dead, and I knew it. I was tempted to let go, knowing that at least I'd robbed the Vangars of a kill. No, I thought. Better to let them shoot me. It'll end faster.
Why don't you cowards fight a real man? A voice shouted below.
I cringed. I glanced sideways and saw Kale rushing the sentinels with a length of soft iron pipe. One of the sentinels turned to face him just in time to take the full brunt of that pipe across his face. His helmet rang like a bell. The pipe bent, bowing slightly at the middle. Unfazed, the sentinel lashed out with his scattergun. Kale leapt deftly aside, responding with a hammering blow to the sentinel's midsection. Inside his armor, the Vangar warrior laughed. The second sentinel watched this interplay for a moment. He decided his assistance wasn't needed and then turned his attention back to me. He raised his scattergun to shoot me but then paused. For some reason, he thought better of it. He replaced the weapon in its sheath and looked up at me. Through the cage of his helmet, I saw a glint of teeth as he smiled wickedly. Suddenly, I understood. I clenched my jaw, my fingernails clawing at the brick wall. The sentinel's suit chugged and whirred as he stepped up to the corner of the building below. He tilted his head back and gazed at me for a moment, and then took a swing at the wall. Bricks exploded outward as his large metallic fist hammered into the structure. A wave of energy rushed up and down the side of the building. A small scream escaped my lips. The surface of the wall behind my back rolled like an ocean wave. The sound of shattering bricks and plaster was almost like breaking glass. I lost traction and slid a few more inches. The leather of my boots caught the ledge and I blinked slowly, taking a deep, shuddering breath. The Vangar nodded approvingly at his handiwork. He smiled again, and then took another swing. This time the wooden stud inside the wall snapped, and the entire corner of the building dropped several inches. I dropped with it, momentarily free-falling. As the building settled, my legs caught the ledge again. I slid a few inches to the side and came to a bouncing halt, my heart racing in my chest, blood rushing dizzily through my head. The wood framing behind the wall creaked and groaned like the hull of a ship in a hurricane. Bricks trickled down. The sentinel let out a deep, rumbling laugh as they bounced off his armor. I twisted my head frantically from side to side, looking for something, anything, to latch onto. I realized that during the partial collapse, the edge of the building had opened up a handhold. I saw exposed timbers, but they were just out of reach. If I could just swing a little closer, I might reach the opening at the edge of the building. Kaboom! The sentinel's fist smashed into the wall again, and the entire corner gave way. The building made a moaning, creaking sound as the top of the wall separated from the structure. It tilted awkwardly outward from the rest of the building, dangling me out over the street. I caught my breath as I realized the entire building was about to collapse on top of me. I twisted my body in a desperate attempt to swing toward the crumbling ledge. As I reached out, I felt the entire section of wall give way beneath me. I reached for the corner that was no longer there and felt my hand close on one of the wall studs. I grabbed it with both hands, pulling myself forward as the bricks collapsed around me. Chunks of brick and plaster rained down, pulverizing my arms, my legs, and the back of my head. I cried out, unable to let go, not daring to look up for fear of having one of those bricks smash me in the face. The board swung out and away from the building as it collapsed. I held on as long as I could until the studs slid from my grip, and the inertia threw me into a free fall. I saw the street coming at me. I did my best to twist into a position where I could roll when I hit the ground, hopefully absorbing some of the impact. I'm not sure if I actually succeeded because the next thing I knew, everything was silent. I was lying flat on my back. My eyes fluttered open and I sucked in a deep breath. A cloud of dust filled the air so thick that I couldn't see more than a few feet in any direction. I instantly started to cough. I felt hands on my shoulders and twisted my head to see Kale trying to lift me. I turned, pushing awkwardly to my feet, and let out a cry as my hand scraped across the cobblestones. I held them out, examining my bloody palms. The board that had saved my life had also rubbed the flesh from my palms and left splinters and gashes all over my hands. I grimaced, pulling one of the larger splinters from my exposed flesh. Kale gave me a dark look. He handed me his gloves and nodded that I should follow him. I accepted them gratefully, wincing as I slid them over my exposed flesh. My mind flashed back to seeing him wielding that iron pipe. "What were you thinking?" I said quietly, wincing as I flexed my hands in the gloves. "What? What were you thinking attacking that sentinel with a pipe? Are you nuts?" He smiled cavalierly. "I had to do something to save you." I rolled my eyes. "Idiot," I mumbled. He shot me a mischievous grin and then broke into a run up the street. I took off after him, ignoring the painful bruises up and down my body. I took half a dozen steps before I realized that I was running with a limp. I glanced down and realized that my leg, too, had been injured. A shard of wood several inches long was sticking out of my thigh. "Wait," I called out quietly. I stopped and bent over to pull the shard free. Kale looked horrified as I yanked the splinter out and a stream of blood trickled from the open wound. "You need a doctor," he whispered. I was going to say I was fine, but I didn't get a chance. We both heard the unmistakable sound of heavy steel boots coming up the street behind us, and we broke into a run. I threw a glance over my shoulder as we ran, and I caught a glimpse of the sentinels racing towards us through the smoke and the dust. Their armor looked red under the light of the moon, and Tinker's warning again came to mind. Perhaps, I thought grimly, I should have listened to the crazy old man. I saw a flash of color on the cobblestones and realized it was my blood. I was leaving a trail that would lead the sentinels directly to us. I threw my gaze up and down the street, trying to formulate a plan. A narrow, winding street opened up to my left. I recognized it as one of the old routes that led down into a seedy southern Dockside neighborhood. "There," I said, pointing. Kale nodded and ran that direction. I let him get a few strides ahead of me, and then I turned and ran the other way. By the time he'd realized what I'd done, it was already too late. The sentinels were between us. I had forced them to either split up or choose one of us to chase. As expected, they chose me. I swerved to the right, climbing north up a narrow street into Hillcrest. 2- and 3-story buildings loomed over me. These were the homes of the working class, the merchants and laborers who were either clever or weak enough to avoid becoming slaves in the mines. Of all the people in Avonston, these were the ones who led relatively normal lives. Hillcrest was about as good as it got. I reached the summit and saw the rest of the Dockside district stretching out below. A smile turned up the corners of my mouth. Those were the streets I knew best. If I couldn't shake the sentinels in Dockside, I deserved to die. I heard thundering footsteps coming up the hill behind me and I took off at a run. My plan had seemed clever enough at first. Lead the sentinels into Dockside and then lose them in the maze of warehouses, shanties, and dark alleys. I'd done it before. It shouldn't have been hard. The one thing I didn't count on was the second patrol of sentinels waiting for me at the bottom of the hill. Halfway down the street, 2 more sentinels stepped around the corner and leveled their scatterguns at me. I was running downhill so fast that I couldn't possibly turn aside without injuring myself. Instead, I used my momentum to leap to the top of a 5-foot wall that ran along the street. I flew along the top of the wall and then leapt up onto a 2nd-floor balcony, slamming into the rail as I landed. I grunted, forcing air back into my lungs and climbed over the rail. The sentinels opened fire and scattergun pellets ricocheted behind me. Chunks of plaster rained down. I broke into a full-out run, launching myself from the balcony rail and caught the edge of the next building. I pulled myself up onto the roof, turning to the northwest, running deeper into Dockside. I made it to the edge of the roof in just a few steps. I leapt into the air, vaulting towards the next rooftop. My legs screamed in pain as I landed, but I forced myself to keep moving. Behind me, I heard the familiar ka-chunk, ka-chunk of a sentinel's brisk walk. One of them had climbed the wall of the building behind me, ripping out bricks and siding all the way up. The entire building shook as he charged across the roof. I caught glimpses of 3 more sentinels in the street below and I began to worry. Fighting a sentinel is a lot like fighting a bear. All weaknesses are simply illusion. They may seem clumsy until you're standing in front of one just trying to stay out of reach. They might seem slow until one of them is chasing you. That's when all of your preconceived notions vanish, and you realize that you'll be lucky just to get away alive. Those were my feelings as I bounded from rooftop to rooftop at full speed, heart pounding in my ears, eyes searching for another way to shake them. I was fast. I had never met a human who could outrun me. Only the Cantors, the tattooed giants from the slaves' mines, might match my speed. Or, of course, a sentinel. And these sentinels were unusually determined. I don't know how long the race lasted. I only know that my body was screaming with pain and I couldn't go on much longer. My lungs ached. I was beginning to feel dizzy from the loss of blood. We'd crossed the rooftops of more than a dozen buildings. I went back down to street level and ran into the narrowest, darkest alleyway I could find. Working my way back and forth through the dregs of Dockside, I was sure that I would lose the sentinels eventually. It had worked in the past. Sooner or later, they would give up the chase. But this time was different. There were more of them, for one thing, and they had never pursued me with such vigor in the past. It was almost as if they feared to return without me. Perhaps that was the reason. Perhaps they had been told to bring me back once and for all, or they would suffer. Regardless, it soon became clear to me that I couldn't go on. I had to find shelter. I had to rest and lick my wounds. I couldn't shake the sentinels long enough to even catch my breath. Every time I came out of an alley, it seemed there was another sentinel waiting for me on the other side. Every time I vanished into the shadows, it seemed more of them came out of the woodwork. There was simply no escape. And suddenly, strangely, I found myself at home. I wasn't entirely sure how I'd gotten there. My mind was a blur of streets, dark alleyways, and rooftops. They were all familiar to me, but in my state of mind, they were all more or less transient. It wasn't until I found myself climbing the front stairs of our two-story shanty that I realized what I had done. Halfway up the stairs, I paused, realizing my horrible mistake. I turned back and saw three sentinels chugging down the street towards me. It was too late to turn back. I had nowhere else to go. I stood there for a moment, struggling with my mistake. Slowly coming to the realization that I only had one choice. I must give myself up. If I didn't, they would find Tinker. Even as I thought his name, I looked up and saw Tinker standing at the front door. The open door behind him hung awkwardly to the side, dangling by a broken hinge that had needed fixing for more than a year. In his arms, Tinker held an old blunderbuss. I recognized it as a weapon he had modified years ago. It didn't shoot bullets or small projectiles. It shot half rounds of cannon charges. It was powerful enough to knock the shooter off his feet if he wasn't careful. My eyes widened as I saw him. "Tinker, get inside!" I said in a desperate panic. "Hide!" He stepped forward, brandishing the weapon. "Get behind me!" He raised the gun over my head and fired. I had just enough time to duck and cover my ears. Tinker twisted sideways from the recoil as he fired, and I felt the concussion of the blast go all the way through my body. Tinker steadied himself and began to reload. I glanced up the street and saw one of the sentinels standing still, his body tilted at an awkward angle. Then I saw the liquid running down his armor and realized it was a mixture of oil and blood. Tinker had killed him. Behind the dead sentinel, many more were coming. I leapt up the stairs and grabbed Tinker by the arm. "Hurry!" I shouted. "We've got to get out of here!" He shrugged me off, locking another charge into the chamber of his weapon. "Get behind me, Breeze! Go out the back!" I narrowed my eyebrows, staring at him. "Tinker?" I said, my voice cracking slightly. "Hurry up now," he said. "Get down to the water. They won't follow in the water. Go, Breeze!" Tears stained my eyes as I stared at him. "Tinker, I'm not Breeze. I'm River." He stared at me for a moment, and then a sly smile broke out across his face. He nodded at me and said, "Go on, child, go!" The whole world crashed down around me. Tears streamed down my cheeks. I no longer felt the pain of my bruised bones or the laceration in my thigh. I didn't feel the grated skin of my palms or the blisters on my arm. I only felt my heart breaking inside of me. I stared at him, confused, wondering. Did he know what he was doing? What was going on in the old man's mind? He must have known he couldn't survive a fight with the sentinels. What he was doing was insane. It didn't make any sense. Tinker impatiently shoved me backwards through the doorway. As I stumbled inside, he let loose another round.
"Come on, then," I heard him shouting. "Come get your medicine, you filthy Vangars."
Suddenly, it all became profoundly clear. Tinker didn't want me to save him. All that he wanted was for me to escape. He wanted me to get away so that I might come back some other day and exact our revenge. He was placing all of his hopes in me the same way that he had in my mother before she died in the wastelands. I knew then that there was nothing I could do for Tinker. He had chosen to sacrifice everything to give me that chance to escape. I owed it to him to survive. I owed it to him to come back and hunt down those sentinels one by one. I turned and ran through the upper room of our shanty, knocking over furniture, leaping into the narrow staircase that led down into Tinker's workshop. I paused on the stairs to grab the spring-powered revolver that I had inherited from my mother. It was resting on the small bookshelf like an old knick-knack. I snatched it up and shoved it into my belt. I flew down to the lower level, racing toward the back door that led out onto the docks. Halfway through the shop, I stopped cold in my tracks. Tinker's workshop was a long, narrow room, like a tunnel. I was standing next to the bench on the outside wall, covered with tools and odds and ends. Tinker's usual assortment of junk. But that wasn't what caught my attention. It was something else. It was the thick, dust-covered canvas resting directly adjacent to the workbench. Or rather, it was the thing under the canvas. It was the bone shaker. Hurriedly, I yanked the canvas off and knelt down, opening the fuel inlet from the tank. Tinker's bone shaker didn't run on steam or springs like most of his inventions. This version, the only one he had ever built, used an engine from one of the Vangar's larger gyroplanes. The bone shaker was something Tinker had called a mechanical horse when he designed it. It wasn't so much that it looked like a horse, but rather the fact that it was long and thin, as opposed to the common wide-bodied steam wagons and similar vehicles. The bone shaker was something different. It was a simple steel frame resting on two wheels, with a handlebar to steer and a seat just big enough for one person. Tinker had designed it to be fast. It was supposed to be a quick and economical way to get from one place to another. A vehicle for the poor. Of course, that was all before Tinker had lost his senses. Soon after finishing the bone shaker, Tinker lost interest in his work. Sadly, the thing had been sitting under the canvas in his shop ever since. I hastily checked the pipe connections and blew the dust off the carburetor. Satisfied that everything was in place, I sat astride the bone shaker and kicked the engine over. It rolled the first time without promise. I kicked again, this time rewarded with a small chugging noise. The third time was a charm. I kicked, and the engine came to life. A cloud of sooty black smoke puffed out the tailpipe. Smiling, I kicked the thing into gear and revved up the throttle. A moment too late, I realized I hadn't bothered to actually open the back door before going through it. The rotten old wood exploded as I hit it, shattering around me as I burst through the doorway. I went roaring down the docks, shaking off the shards of wood, ignoring the slivers in my knuckles and shoulders. As I bounced down the uneven surface of the dock, I noticed a jarring pain moving up and down my entire body. I suddenly remembered why we had decided to call the vehicle a bone shaker. It didn't have any suspension. It vibrated like a hammer beneath me, rattling the teeth right out of my head. Over the roar of the engine, I heard the explosions of Tinker's blunderbuss in front of our shanty, and the loud burst of the sentinel's return fire. I hit the brakes and spun in a half circle, craning my neck for a clear view. For a split second, everything seemed to go quiet. Tinker had retreated into the shanty. The sentinels followed him inside. 3 seconds later, the shanty exploded. There was a massive wallop and a fireball rolled up into the air, riding a cloud of smoke that mushroomed out in a broad circle. All of Dockside shook, and the sound of the explosion echoed back and forth across the city. For a moment, the flames lit up the night sky, and the entire city turned bright red. I stared with my jaw hanging open as bits and pieces of burning wood started raining down. Bystanders began to gather along the docks to stare at the hole where our shanty used to be, stamping out the fires before they spread to the buildings nearby. It took a moment for me to realize that the sentinels were gone. Tinker had tricked them into following him inside before setting off the massive explosion. He'd done it on purpose. Tears flooded my vision. I couldn't help but think of my father. He had done the same thing to save my mother. He had sacrificed himself, dive-bombing a Vanguard dragon ship with his gyro to help her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.